think about them as abstract concepts of power, theories, war games. But this is what nuclear weapons are. And if we keep nuclear weapons forever, they will be used again. And this will happen. And there is literally no preparedness to deal with this. There's nothing relief agencies or national authorities can do to help people. We have, for example, have the Red Cross do research on what they would do as an emergency relief factor in terms of helping survivors. They said they will pull their stuff out. They can't help. The UN humanitarian agencies did the same thing. They say we're powerless. We can't do anything.
But, you know, when you say this is the reality of nuclear weapons, it was the reality of the nuclear weapons that were used in 1945. I guess the point that so many strategists, thinkers on international security issues would make to you is that actually the fact that the big world powers have maintained their nuclear weapons deterrent over the last seven decades has actually ensured that they have not been used, and that actually we have not had major wars between those big powers since the Second World War.
Well, I wouldn't agree with that. I think that nuclear weapons have, we've been very close to use of nuclear weapons several times during the world, Cold War.
But isn't that the point of deterrence, that ultimately you can get close, you can have huge confrontation, you can have wars, even by proxy, but you cannot step over that line because of the theory of mutually assured destruction that comes with these weapons, for whom Setsuko's testimony is the ultimate bearing witness.
One day it will fail. We're seeing right now it's being threatened to use. We're seeing a world leaders actually talking about totally destroying not just a city, not just the regime, but a whole country, for example. And that's really, really dangerous. And we also have multiple threats now. We have many more actors with nuclear weapons. We have terrorists. We have cybersecurity issues. We have so many accidents. There's a lot of research coming out right now also on how close to accidents we were during the Cold War, misunderstandings. They thought a weather satellite was an incoming missile. And one person in the Soviet Union said, that doesn't feel right. He disregarded orders. So we've been, nuclear weapons has pushed us to the brink so many times, and they are fueling conflicts today. The war in Iraq, for example, that was really based on this issue of weapons of mass destruction. We have a tense situation in Iran, in Kashmir, between India and Pakistan, and right now with North Korea. Nuclear weapons are not solving that problem. Nuclear weapons are fueling that.
Let's unpick a little bit of the work you've done, the work which has led to you receiving this amazing prize here in Oslo. I suppose more than anything else, you got the prize this year because you were in the ICAN, in the international campaign, were the driving force behind this international treaty, which more than 120 countries approved, which outlaws, prohibits nuclear weapons. The big problem with that treaty is that it does not include the support of any of the nations that currently have nuclear weapons. And that surely discredits it as a meaningful treaty.
Absolutely not. We see with other treaties, for example, that norms can be very powerful and influence behavior, also with states that are not parties to them. For example, with landmines, we've seen the big producers of landmines, even though they didn't sign the treaty, they have shifted their behaviors. We've seen the market for landmines drop. We've seen efforts to clean up landmines being done, saving people's lives continuously because of the treaty.
Just one practical question on how this treaty works, because it is so central to the work you do. You say that when 50 countries have formally ratified it, then it will become international law. My question is, what does that really mean if the United States, Russia, China, let alone countries like North Korea, and we might talk about more in a minute, if those nations do not accept this quote-unquote international law, what meaning does it have?
It will still impact their behavior and sort of shift the norms.
How and why?
For example, we can ask banks to divest from nuclear weapons production. And we've seen that, for example, with the Cluster Munitions Convention, that the U.S. did not participate or sign. But last year, Textron, the last American producer of cluster munitions, stopped producing cluster munitions, saying there's a growing international stigma it's bad business to keep investing in this weapon. And even if perhaps the Trump administration now is trying to reverse some policies, the companies have said, no, we're not going to do this.
Setsuko, I want to quote to you something that... I wanted to quote to you something the Nobel Committee said in their citation in giving the award. They said this: we live in a world today where the risk of nuclear weapons being used is greater than it has been for a very long time.
It's been 72 years. Scientific advanced place. The risks are far greater today than 75 years ago. I thought what I experienced in that city was a catastrophic disaster. But if anything like, another bomb is used, human suffering is not going to be that scale. The whole city, whole region, even half of the continent could be melting away. That kind of different situation from 72 years ago. And somehow I think it's a madness to think that deterrence theory works. Therefore, we managed not to have the war past so many years.
Well, I'm not sure that deterrence theory seems so implausible if one considers the strategies of the United States, Russia, and China. But I do want to talk to you particularly about North Korea, because we've seen the North Koreans develop their nuclear weapons program in recent weeks and months. We now know that they have quite an advanced capability, not just to weaponize, but also then to miniaturize so they could put it on an intercontinental ballistic missile. We've seen those tests. Now, for you, as a Japanese citizen, albeit a woman who now lives in Canada, surely that gives you pause. I mean, Japan right now is protected by the American nuclear umbrella. Are you suggesting to me that the Japanese people would be happy to see the Americans give up their nuclear weapons and for Japan to lose that protection?
I think many serious Japanese are thinking that maintaining that alliance relationship with the United States, which is ready to use nuclear weapon as a first strike weapon. And that makes Japan more vulnerable.
On a human level, what is your reaction when you hear Donald Trump talk about fire and fury?
I want to doesn't understand there are millions of human beings who could suffer from this. And I have seen so many 100,000 people melt away. And how inhuman can we be? That's totally unacceptable moral behavior. I would tell him that. And I would say the same to the North Korean leader as well. They are behaving totally unacceptably.
There's a verification issue here as well. I mean, in the not-so-distant past, we saw Iran tell lies about the nature of its nuclear program. They were exposed, ultimately, by the IAEA, and now Iran is under a very strict monitoring program. But we know it's easy to disguise nuclear developments, including military developments. Now, I'm just going to quote you the words of one expert in this field, a nuclear physicist, Peter Zimmerman. He says that in the end, some hydrogen bombs are small enough to hide in a coat closet. Verification of their destruction in the absence of a yet-to-be-determined mechanism, because he says nothing you talk about is specific, and in the absence of a strong international consensus, verification is impossible. And with regard to North Korea, for example, isn't that a truth that means the big powers cannot sacrifice their nuclear weapons?
No, because as long as some countries keep nuclear weapons, you will incite proliferation. If a country like Britain has spent the last 70 years arguing that nuclear weapons equal safety, of course a country like North Korea is going to think the same, or Iran. Why wouldn't they? I think that we are never going to be able to address the proliferation challenges until we start rejecting nuclear weapons as an acceptable means of protecting ourselves. Threatening to mass murder civilians should not be a legitimate way of ensuring safety. It creates unsafety and it creates a heightened risk for war. So when we address that, the verification, the technical challenges, will be solved. It is the political will that needs to happen.